All right, so today in the class of botany, we are going to study about a very structural and outer part of the plant that is called the epidermis. So basically, epidermis is the outermost layer, which is a very protective and the very first layer inside the any anatomical portion inside the plant. Whether we're going to talk about the stem or root or leaf, epidermis is the outermost structure in all the parts present inside the plant body. So let's take a look how epidermis look like. So if we are going through the introduction part here, so like a major brief introduction about epidermis. So the outermost layer or layer of cell covering all plant organ are the epiderm. So as I already told you that the epidermis is the outermost covering and protective layer is present inside the each and every organ of the plant. Even in the human skin, we call it the derma. But if we are talking about the plants here, like our topic is in the plant anatomy, so we have to know that this structure is basically belongs to the plant organs. So now it is direct contact with the environment, and so it modifies itself to cope up with the natural surroundings. So you can say the epidermis is the thing which have to deal with everything. Okay, everything is like environment, climatic changes, temperature, humidity, rain, whatever the natural hazards which are present in surroundings, they have, or you can say epidermis have to deal with all, and their major function is to protect the plant or inside body from outside surroundings. So that's why this epidermis, they really need to be very careful about their formation, or what kind of things they can taking in or giving out. So that's why this tissue have a very important features, and they are having a very important place inside the plant anatomy. So let's begin with this. So they protect the inner tissue from any adverse natural calamities like the high temperature, desiccation, mechanical injury, external infection, etc. So there are many things which have to be dealt or which going through by the epidermis. So they deal with it. So basically their protection is their favorite work. Like they have to protect the plant from outer any mechanical injury or anything which can going to harm the plant, epidermis need to protect them. So in some plant, epidermis may persist throughout the life, while in other, it is replaced by periderm when the epidermis slotted off along with the underlying tissue. So what happened, like all the plant have different features, okay? They, like they'll be talking about the very small plants, like bryophyte, pteridophyte, they do not have a very long lifespan, and also they do not show the secondary growth inside them. So in this feature, the epidermis feature, that is basically you can say they are resistant to the monocotyledon thing, or sometimes the lower plants like thallophyta, bryophyta and pteridophyta. But the plants like angiosperm, or you can see the very highly developed plant which have to show secondary growth. In those kind of plants, these epidermis will be replaced by the periderm formation, because when the secondary growth will take place inside the plant body, they will have to replace the epidermis in the formation of the periderm. You see the very brown bark formation on the stem of the plant. Okay, that brown bark formation, that is the result of periderm formation. At that time, periderm formation, this epidermis need to lay off. So that's why this at that time, this epidermis can be replaced. This is the structure you can see here, the structure of a basically the epidermal tissue structure. In this, you can see the very outer first layer. This is the epidermis. Okay, and this upper epidermis basically, and this cuticle covering will be present on the upper epidermal side. Now, why this cuticle present here? Because the very work function cuticle is against the water. Okay, anything like very hydrated situation, or you can see the very heavy rain formation have take place sometimes. So that at that time, cuticle need to protect the epidermis. So But cuticle is not a fundamental feature that have to be present in every kind of plant. They mostly present at those plants which have to be faced more water situation. So that's why we cannot say that cuticle is like a particularly very basic part of the plant anatomy. But cuticle is situation-based thing which have to be present inside the plant body. So now this is upper epidermis. That will be, this is the diagram of a leaf basically. So after this upper epidermis, they are having this mesophyll tissue which are going to perform the photosynthesis, as it is a leaf anatomy. So, but only leaf, the characteristic feature of this lower epidermis tissue and upper epidermis tissue, this is only present inside the leaf anatomical portion. Neither the stem nor the root, they don't have any kind of lower or upper epidermis. They just have one kind of epidermis which surrounds them. And this upper epidermis and lower epidermis, this is the basic feature that present only inside the leaf. Next, if we will see the origin, where from at what position these originate. So basically, epidermis of all organ originate from the outermost layer of the apical meristem. As in the very first unit, we studied about the theories of origin, like or theories of apical meristem, in which we studied the histrogen theory, we studied about the apical meristem theory of apical cell theory, Kappa-Gappe theory. So these are a lot of kind of meristem theories we have been studying. So in all these meristem theories, the outermost layer of all the theories, like if we are talking about the apical cell theory or histrogen theory, but whenever they are divided in some layers, or these very first or outermost layer of all the theories, that outermost layer will be formed or converted into the epidermis. So Habertland, Henstein and Smith, they were the botanists, a very famous one, called the surface layer of meristem as protoderm. Okay, protoderm, dermatogen, tunica. So these basically, Habertland that coined the term protoderm, Henstein that coined the term dermatogen, and the Schmitz, they give the term tunica. So these three terms which have been given on the basis of apical meristem theories, these three layers are, you can say, committed to form or convert it into the epidermis in plant body. In cryptogams, if we talk about cryptogams, non-vascular plants, or you can say the non-seeded plant which do not have seed inside them, we call them the cryptogams. So cryptogam epidermis originates from a single initial cell that also form cortex and steep. In the cryptogam epidermis, that single initial cell which they are talking about, a single initial cell, that is apical cell theory. We already studied about the apical cell theory, how apical cell theory grow and convert into a whole plant by a single cell. So that single cell which have a tetrahedral openings. So in from that tetrahedral opening, one which is present a very outside, that will be going to convert into the epidermis. The epidermis of gymnosperm root originates and associated with root cap from periphlegm. In dicotyledon root, epidermis develop from initial of dermatogen, which are not distinct from those of root cap. But in the case of what happened in the root formation, when the root formation takes place inside the plant body, then not only the epidermis which is going to form outside, but also in the root formation time, there will be the formation of root cap take place. This root cap and the formation of root cap and the epidermis inside the root, they will be developed by the same tissue. Just the root cap is a furthermore outer part of the epidermis here, because root cap are designed for the absorption of water and minerals from the surroundings and from the soil. But as this is also a very outermost part, like the epidermis and all other organs, so that's why they are, hence their pattern of origin is same. So as we are studying origin here, so the origin of this root and origin of that root cap are basically similar. This is all about the origin. Now we will see the structure and content, like how the epidermis is formed, what kind of structure they have, and what kind of contents. So usually the epidermis consists of one layer cells. Okay, this is very basic and fundamental thing about epidermis. Most of, like you can see this, like 90% of epidermis, they are just formed by single layer. Okay, if you don't know anything about epidermis and someone asks you about what kind of epidermis is present in this kind, I'm damn sure that 99.9% it will be a single layer epidermis. Several layer epidermis, termed as multiple epidermis, they also found, but inside some leaves only. Like there are the leaves of the ficus, neerum, and in the aerial roots of orchid. These are the some leafy particles in which we are having this multiple layer epidermis. The initial of epidermis derived perikinally to form multiple epidermis. So very first, when the formation of epidermis is going to take place, at that time, the very first division that will happen inside this epidermis formation, that will be perikinal division. Okay, after this perikinal division, they will be having the anticlinal division also. So anticlinal division only happen inside those epidermis which have to be multiply or multiple layer epidermis. So in these leaves which are having multiple epidermis basically, in that case only we will be having this anticlinal division. Otherwise, we are just going to form the epidermis by the perikinal divisions. Just wait a minute. So now, as we already know, like their structural content, so the multiple epidermis of orchid root has a special name. We call them velamen. This is, you can say this question comes in very competitive exams also, that the epidermis of which plant root have the special name epidermis, we call them the velamen. Okay, the orchid root, their epidermis will be known as the velamen. The epidermis of aerial part of the plant consists of living parent diameter cells whose shape, size, arrangement may differ. So basically, when we talk about the content or the cell type of the epidermis, they are mostly the parenchyma cell. So parenchyma cell are the basic feature of the epidermis, but their shape and their size and their arrangement, they can be different from species to species. Means like they can be of any shape, or they can be oval, they can be barrel shaped, they can be slight elongated, they can be round, or they can be sometimes isodiametric in shapes. But size, like sometimes they are present very compactly, sometimes they are loosely arranged, sometimes their size is small, sometimes they are little large. That basically their arrangement, their shape and their size, that is basically, you can say they are depend on the what kind of habitat their plant is present. So according to their need, according to the plant need, they will be different or vary. The epidermis are more or less tabular, so horizontally flattened. Okay, tabular means they are horizontally flattened. In cross-sectional view, in leaves, the epidermis cell wall appear as senescence in dicot and in monocot. They appear as straight or senescent surface. So they can be depend on what angle we are watching them. So sometime in dicot, they appear as senescence. And in monocot, they generally look like sometimes straight and or sometimes senescence if we are going to see in a surface view. Usually the cells of epidermis are compactly set with none of your intercellular space. Most of the time, when we see the arrangement of the cells inside the epidermis, they're compactly arranged, means there will be no intercellular gap present inside one of each cells. So no intercellular space present inside the cells, so they are the very compactly present cells, though without having any intercellular gap, like the flower, the petals, and sometimes also some leafy structure, like if you are talking about a leaf which is present inside a xerophytic condition, at that time leaf have to be, your epidermis have to be very compact, because to reduce the rate of transpiration. The epidermal cells are devoid of chloroplast, epidermal cells do not contain chloroplasts because they cannot do the photosynthesis work because they need to have other works to do, like production, gaseous exchange, and many other works which have been done by the epidermal cell. So that's why they do not contain the chloroplast. The guard cell of the stomata that are specialized epidermal cell contain chloroplast. But in the epidermal tissue, there will be a structure called stomata, which is responsible for the transpiration process and gaseous exchange. So that is stomata, which have two kidney-like shaped cells, that is called the guard cells. And these guard cells, they are having the chloroplast in them. So this chloroplast, they can do the function for the photosynthesis, but not the epidermal cell. Other pigment like anthocyanin may occur in epidermal cell. So there are some pigments also which present inside the cell of epidermis, and they can make them colorful. The anthocyanin that can give a little yellowish color. In some plants, silica may be deposited in the epidermal cell, set either in the alumina wall, and the wall of the trichomes may be silicified. So basically the silica. This is also an interesting fact, the presence of the silica inside the epidermal cell. Why is silica present inside the epidermal cell? What are their function to do? So basically, they are present just to reduce the rate of water loss. If the silica is present, then they will be impermeable for the water. So like if we are having the plant that is in very hydrophobic condition or in very xerophobic condition. So at that place, when the plant facing xerophobic or hydrophobic condition, in that case, we need silica type of thing inside our epidermis, which can help to reduce the water, or also they can reduce the absorption of water in the case of hydrophyte. And in the case of xerophyte, they can reduce the transpiration rate. So that's why the silica is present inside the epidermis. Now, let's begin with more structural analysis of epidermal cells. So they are thin. Means their cell wall is thin. Thick-walled lignified epidermal cell occurs in some gymnosperm. Sometimes their wall can be thick or lignified. Means deposition of the lignin can be happen on the epidermal cell in gymnosperm. Okay, that gymnosperm, basically these plants face a very xerophytic condition. So that's why they need some extra protection inside them. So that's why in that case, epidermal cell wall of gymnosperm, they have some lignification. Cutin, a fatty substance, is very often deposited on the outer surface of the epidermal cell wall to form cuticle over which wax may also be deposited. Now there is another term, that is cutin. We already talked about the cuticle. So cutin is a component that made cuticle over the epidermal cell. And we already discussed that the cuticle function is to protect the cell. Not only the protection by water, they also protect the plant by the some harmful or poisonous insect bite. Okay, sometimes some insect come and sit on the plant surface. At that time, what they do, they can release some poisonous substances, and releasing of that poisonous substances might get plant hurt. So at that time, these wall, basically this cuticle, going to save the plant. Cuticle often preserve the characteristic feature of epidermal surface, such as type and distribution of hair and stomata. Sometimes cuticle also preserve like some other characteristic, like epidermis also has some hairs. Stomata, we already know, they have stomata for the gaseous exchange and transpiration. Also they have hairs. Case if the hairs are present in the case of root epidermis, they will be for the better rate of absorption of water and mineral from the soil. If they are present on the stem, then they have various functions to do. They can basically secure the lenticles opening. They can help to capture some pollen grain to the plant. They can also sometimes reduce the transpiration rate, or sometimes they can increase the gaseous exchange. So there are many functions that can be done by the hairy appearance on the stem. So does the fossil plant may be identified by cuticular studies? So these all things which are present inside the cuticle of epidermis, like here was the stomata, On the basis of that, we can also do the fossil study. We know fossils are the study of very evolutionary plants, the plants which have been present so many of our past studies. So basically that fossil plant can be done by, or fossil studies can be done by this particular studies. Palmer in 1976 used the fossil grasses cuticle instead of grass pollen. So here, some most of the scientists, they studied about the pollen. Pollen study is very common for the fossil studies, but the fossil grass cuticle, the Palmer in 1976, he studied the fossil by their cuticle. So we can also say that they are a new Palmer ecological tool for the reconstruct the nature of past vegetation of East African lake sediments. So basically you can say they can be a paleoecological tools. Paleobotany is a study of fossils, and if we are having something by which we can do that ecological paleoecological study, that's why we can call them the paleoecological tool. So hence our cuticle is being a paleoecological tool. In many plant wax is deposited on the surface of cuticle. So this wax also, now a new feature here on the epidermis, that is wax. They are deposited on the surface of cuticle. So this form a powdery coating on various fruit, like you can see the grapes and the palm and some leaves. They are some powder-like appearance on them. So this powder and the glossy two appearance, two in the two form the wax can be present. Okay, if they are dry and break out, they will be in a powder form. But if they are having the water inside them, they will be glossy. So this give a glossy appearance to the surface of leaf and fruit, and wax is deposited either in the form of granules, rod, tubes, which form various specific pattern on the surface. So not every time when wax is going to be present on a surface, they do not give glossy appearance all the time. Sometimes they can make some specific pattern also, like what kind of specific pattern they can make. Like you can see, they can make some granule, some rod and tube-like structures. Now we will see some part of epidermal tissue. Here we are having hairs. So hairs, they are present all over the surface of the plant organ, mostly root, stem, leaf and floral parts, okay? And they are the most important part of the plant. So you can say that all the most important part of the plant, they are having hairs. By the root hairs, we already discussed, for the increasing the rate of absorption of water and mineral. Why the stem? I already told you about how the stem hair help them for the capturing the pollen, for lenticles opening, and sometimes the gaseous exchange, or they can also reduce the rate of transpiration. Leaves, the same work which have to be done on the stem, that can be done inside the leaves, that like rate of evaporation can be reduced by the help of hairs. And also you can say that sometimes they are helped to folding in the leaves. If the plant facing some kind of xerophytic situation, so in that case, these hairs will going to help them for the protection of, in terms of transpiration. Floral part, in that case, flowers are the very attractive thing inside a plant body. So that's why some insect can be come and catch them. So at that time, these hairs basically protect the floral surfaces. Seed also, the protection of the seed. And second thing of the seed hair work is for the pollination thing, like, or sometimes seed germination process. Because with the help of the hair, the seed can fly, okay, by the wind. When the wind happen, flow a little fast, at that time, these seed can be traveled with the help of hairs. Root hairs, we already studied. Some other hairs than the root hair, they are trichomes. Like, they also like a very thread-like structure present on the epidermal cells. They can be unicellular or multicellular, means they can be formed by the single cell or they can be formed by the multiple cells. If we are talking about a multicellular hair here, so they may be composed of a single linear row of cell or several rows, okay? That not every time they are having very much cells, Also, they can be made up of like 3 to 4 cells in a linear layer. Also, we have to call them the multicellular because they are more than two. Trichomes, either unicellular or multicellular, classified into glandular or non-glandular. So these unicellular or multicellular now further classified on the basis of their gland production, or you can say some secretory organism nature. If they are going to secrete some function, or if their function is for the secretion, so they will be the glandular. If they are not going to secrete anything, so they will be the non-glandular. So just on the basis of their secretion, they can be the glandular one and they can be the non-glandular one. So it is believed that the non-glandular trichomes are protective in function and may prevent underwater loss. So if we see, if they are not secreting something, why they are present there? So maybe their function is to prevent water losses. And glandular, they have to secrete something, whatever the waste product that has been formed inside the plant body, that have to be out. And in that case, these glandular trichomes help plant to secrete these things out. So you can see some glandular here, or some, you can see the diagrammatic representation of all the kind of epidermis. Very first here you can see these are the trichomes. Okay, these are the trichome, and this, or so this is a unicellular here. This is the epidermal cell which is present here. This is a single layer unicellular here. This is the trichomes. Trichomes always a little more ingrowth pattern, okay? They are more growing in nature as comparison to the hair. Hair cell limited edition, you can say. They do not grow very much further as the other, but they are having these, a limited growth pattern, while in trichomes, they can be further. This is the multicellular trichome. You can see they are having several cells, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. So a lot of cells is present inside the multicellular. So you can also see this is also a multicellular. This is also a multicellular, but they are having just 1, 2, 3, 4 cells. But this is also a multicellular. So they can be vary in size. Sometimes they can be glandular, sometimes they cannot be glandular. Also, if we see here, woody hair of Branca, the C-section, roots always have this spiral coiling type hairs inside them. And if we talk about dendroids here of Mimosa, this is the dendroid, this kind of formation. When you have two lateral, it's a thorn-like structure from having some central part, and they are having some lateral beads from around them. So in that case, you can see them. There are kind of the dendroids here. Next, you will also see in the case of tree, that are the palate here in surface and side view of Olea. You can see they even look like a flower, okay? But they are not flower, but they are a type of hair. But this is called the palate hair surface, okay? That is a side view, but they look like a glandular flower structure. Now, a very special feature of the epidermal cell, and this special feature mainly occurs inside the monocotyledon plant. Okay, monocotyledon plant, most of the have this bulliform cell. You cannot actualize how important they are for the epidermal tissue of any monocotyledon plant. How they are very important, let's discuss this. So basically, these bulliform cells, they present mostly inside the monocotyledon leaves. They are the motor cells, okay? They are very different in their shape. They are in the middle portion, they are very thick, and they are having the tapering ant-type formation. This bulliform cell basically help the monocotyledon plant for the folding of the leaf. These monocotyledon plant, which have a very wide range of the xerophytic characteristic. So if some plant facing the xerophytic characteristic, what they need? They need a plant cell which have to be reduce the rate of transpiration, which is store water, or if there is a time of very windy or hot temperature, at that time they needed to fold their leaf inside so they can be protected. So at that, in all that situation, this bully form cell can help very much. Like, they are the fan-like appearance in cross section and very large size. So when the time is come and when the seed, when the epidermis of a leaf have to be folded, then this median cell of bully form, which is the tallest one and very gradual ends, they can just move and fold the whole epidermis. So that's why this is called the bully form cells, because they are very largest at the middle. Next, also, they are also the thin wall. They do not have any kind of thick wall, but they have a very large vacuolated structure. Why they are having the very large vacuole? Because of the basic function of the vacuoles is that they need to store something. So bully form cells, they are present inside the epidermis, and whatever the thing they are getting from the outside, like a very tiny amount of water, very tiny amount of any kind of nutrition or the thing which is needed for the development of the plant, that can be stored abundantly inside the bully form cells because of having their large vacuole cell. This is the function. Some other function also that bully form cell perform is called as the motor cells. Okay, because they regulate many function inside the plant body. What is the function of motor? Like, if we are living on the first floor, we don't need a motor to upward direction for the water. But if we are living on a third floor, we need water to go up. So that's what, this is the same process bully form cell do. If something have to be pressurized from top to the bottom or bottom to the top, if they are present in the lower epidermis, or they have to be sent something on an upper epidermal area, then they can generate the pressure and mostly they can easily transfer the cell, transfer the material. So this is the basic features which are present inside the bully form cell. So this is all about the epidermis. I think if we see the summarized version of epidermis, they are the single layer, or sometime in the some leaf they are the multicellular, or if we see they are the made up of, most of the time they are made up of the parenchyma tissue. Okay. And this is very rare that they are having some lignification on them. If we see what are the things which are present inside the epidermis, they can be the stomatas, hair, lenticles, trichomes, bully form cells. So these are the major parts which are present inside the epidermis cell. And if we see their major function, so they are the very protective outer covering, so they need to do protection. They help in the gaseous exchange, they help in the transpiration, and also they help in the providing a basic structure to the plant. So I think you all got about everything in epidermis, and now you will manage to answer these questions. Like, the you need to correctly match something which is more relatively. Secondly, the ciliated columnar epithelium present in which kind of plant? Which type of cell into the blood vessels? Peptide and adhering junction are found in which type of epithelial cell in stratum granified? And epithelial tissue is having the flat and closely that are arranged, which are following layers of actively dividing cells. Tissue having very less or no intercellular matrix is. The inner lining of the vagina, urethra, and oesophagus is made up of. Simple cubicular epithelium is found in. So these were the questions I think you are going to answer. But if you wanted to have some more knowledge on this whole epidermis role inside the plant or their structure, you can also go through these references. They will be a very huge help for you if you wanted more knowledge on the epidermal part. But I think this is all about the epidermis, the structure analysis, the function. But still, if you have any questions, then you can ask me.